Good morning, class. We begin with a new chapter in history called the 18th century India. Now, as we all know that India was during this time, we are dealing with the medieval period, you remember? We talked of Aurangzeb and his work as the last Mughal ruler. You remember? We talked of before him, we talked of the Delhi Sultanate, which had the slave dynasty, then the Tughlaqs, Khaljis, Lodhis, and finally the coming of Babur, etc. Sayyids and Lodhis, then Babur. You remember? Then after Babur, we had these Mughals, and the last of the Mughal rulers who was remarkable was Aurangzeb. You remember that? Girls, I get distracted when you talk. Aap samajh loge to mera kuch nahi jayega, aapka bhala. All ears here so that you give happiness to your parents through your hard work. If you do not pay attention, trust me, I'll get my salary in the end of the month. What I'm worried is my children should get the proper result of me teaching and you understanding it. That is why you are here for, right? So pehle wo kar lo, fir baatein kar lo. So here we are. We talk of the time when after Aurangzeb, there was no strong ruler to hold back the kingdom. Okay, the Delhi throne was in hands of weaker rulers after Aurangzeb. And that was the period when we talk of the 18th century India. That means the rulers were weak. There was no constancy. There was no proper hold. And because of that, there were various uprisings from all over. Everyone was trying to dominate and turn out to be the king of their territory. Clear? So that was the time we talk of now. Okay? So let us begin with the chapter. The 18th century India. The 18th century India in India saw the emergence of many independent kingdoms. Since the Mughal Empire was no longer a strong political entity, ambitious governors carved out autonomous principalities. The Mughal dynasty continued to linger on, but the kings neither had power nor territory. Now, this first paragraph tells you in detail the condition at that time. The kings were weak. The Mughal rulers were weak, and because of that, the nobles and various other people, they tried to carve out, draw out their own principalities. What are principalities? The kingdoms, the small territories. They started thinking themselves that, okay, I'm the owner of this particular area and I will not listen to what king has to say. I will follow what my heart desires. So this had started happening. And though the Mughal Empire was still going on with weak rulers in it, but they had no proper hold left. So the other powerful nobles and rulers, they tried to draw out and carve out their own personal territories, and they became rulers of those small areas. They did not listen to the Mughal kings anymore. Clear? And this was the time of the 18th century. So we talk of the later Mughal Empire. That means the early Mughal Empire was the one which began with Babur and which ended with Aurangzeb. All these were the, in between the rulers were very powerful Mughal rulers. Clear? Babur, Humayun, Akbar, Shah Jahan, and all these were very powerful, and Aurangzeb, all these were very powerful rulers. But when we talk of the later Mughals, those were the ones who were weak rulers. Clear? So we begin with them, the later Mughal Empire. As there was no law of succession among the Mughals, so every time a king died, there was a war among the possible contenders to the throne in which several princes and nobles were killed. After the death of Aurangzeb, a war of succession broke out among his sons as well. And his eldest son, Bahadur Shah, came out victorious to succeed him on the Mughal throne. So very obvious, after Aurangzeb, the war of succession began. Now, what is war of succession? That means all these sons or the king's children, they fought among themselves. There was no law of succession. It wasn't that the king, after his death, the eldest son would get the throne. No, they were following that whoever is more reliable and more strong can rule. So in that case, there was always, after the death of any king, there was a war of succession. That means the siblings used to fight among themselves, and whoever was stronger came out to be the victorious one, and he took over the throne. Clear? So in this case, after Aurangzeb, who was the one who came out victorious among all the other sons of Aurangzeb? It was Bahadur Shah. Clear? And he became powerful. So let us see Bahadur Shah I. This is what he is known as. He ruled from 1707, that means after the death of Aurangzeb, till 1712. Can you see such a small period? Just for 4 or 5 years he ruled. Right? Let us see. Bahadur Shah I, Aurangzeb's successor, ruled for a few years. He tried to win over the Rajputs by recognizing Ajit Singh as the ruler of Jodhpur. He also tried to appease the Marathas by releasing Shahu, the grandson of Shivaji, and offering him a high administrative post. He also sought the friendship of the Sikhs. Bahadur Shah I died in 1712 AD, and the wars of succession followed and culminated in the accession of Jahandar Shah. So now please listen very carefully. For a small little period till Bahadur Shah was there, all he did was try to be friends with everybody. So the first powerful people were around him were the Rajputs. So he went there, and then at that time Ajit Singh was a very powerful ruler. So what he did was he himself made him the ruler and proclaimed him the ruler of Jodhpur. So this is a small piece of information which you should underline and remember. Ajit Singh, ruler of Jodhpur. Then next what he did was, he also gave, appeasement. Now, appease means? To please the Marathas. Unko khush, jise kehte na, khush karne ke liye, unhone kya kiya? He had captured, captivated Shahu, the grandson of Shivaji. He released him. Bahadur Shah released Shahu and he sent him back so that the Marathas could feel happy. Just to please them, he sent Shahu, who Marathas were always a threat to the Mughals. Always, just as Rajputs were always a threat to the Mughals. But what he did was, because he knew he was not that brave, Bahadur Shah knew he was not that capable also. So what he did was, he tried to be friendly with all the others so that everything went off peacefully. Then he also tried to be friends with the Sikh people. Sikhs were the another important clans who were, very dominating and very powerful. So to please all, he started behaving in a very friendly manner with them. Clear till here? Moving further. The last paragraph says that in 1712, when he died, there was again the wars of succession and followed and culminated in the accession of Jahandar Shah. So Jahandar Shah was the next person who acquired the throne after Bahadur Shah I died. So there was again war of succession. His children again started fighting and taking the advantage. Now the next person who came to the throne was Jahandar Shah. Okay. Now his tenure was 1712 to 1713. Can you imagine just 1 year? Now you can understand how weak these Mughal rulers were. They didn't have a proper stability to hold back the empire. So let us see. After the death of Bahadur Shah I, a war of succession broke out. Jahandar Shah emerged victorious and ruled for a few months. He was a puppet in the hands of Zulfikar Khan. Please underline, puppet in the hands of Zulfikar Khan. Puppet in the hands means he was acting as a katputli. Kiske haath ki katputli thi? Zulfikar Khan ke. Theek hai? The most powerful noble of the time. And who was Zulfikar Khan? He was the powerful noble who was at that time helping and guiding Bahadur Shah. Yeah. Bahadur Shah won, and after his death, it was Zulfikar Khan who took Jahandar Shah as a puppet in his hands. Jahandar Shah used to do everything what Zulfikar Khan told him to do. Clear? And Jahandar Khan was overthrown by his nephew Farrukh Shiar. Now, very soon what happened, Jahandar Khan was already in the hands, acting as a puppet of Zulfikar Khan. So what happened was, Zulfikar Khan sided with Farrukh Shiar. Gradually, usko pata chal gaya ki ye Jahandar Khan kisi kaam ka nahi hai. So what he did was, Zulfikar sided with Farrukh Shiar, who was a nephew of Jahandar Khan. And once he sided, he made Farrukh Shiar the king. So the next king who overthrew his own uncle and took over the power was Farrukh Shiar. Okay, so next, let's see. Now Farrukh Shiar, from 1713 till 1719, again such a small span of just 5-6 years. Let us see. Farrukh Shiar was a ruler only in name. The empire was controlled by the Sayyid brothers, and their names are Abdullah Khan Baraha, and Hussain Ali Khan Baraha. They were known as the kingmakers. In 1719 AD, they removed Farrukh Shiar from the throne. Within a gap of a few months, they placed and removed two more rulers. Finally, they declared Muhammad Shah as the emperor. Ab suno kya hua? Once Farrukh Shiar came to the throne, he thought that, oh my God, now I have all the powers. But actually, it wasn't so. The power was actually in control of two Sayyid brothers. And what were their names? Please underline them. The name of two Sayyid brothers, Abdullah Khan Baraha and Hussain Ali Khan Baraha. Now, these were the two people who were manipulating and making kings. Unko jisko man hota tha, usko king bana dete the. They themselves did not acquire the throne. Why? Because they knew ki hame power ko, already hame backseat pe power mil raha hai, toh why to get the throne and get ourselves into trouble? So what they used to do is, kisi bhi donkey, kisi bhi weak, kisi bhi stupid kind of a person ko, wo powerful banane ke liye unko rulers bana dete the. So basically, they were making kings. So that is why they were also known as the kingmakers. Wo jisko chahe, wo usko raja bana de. Clear? Did you understand what are kingmakers? So these two brothers, they considered themselves as the kingmakers. And they were the Sayyid brothers, and you need to know their names. So what happened was, what these Sayyid brothers did was, they replaced, in 1719, they replaced Farrukh Shiar. And with whom they replaced him? Muhammad Shah. Another person called Muhammad Shah came to the throne. And can you see, for such short spans, from 1707, that means after the death of Aurangzeb, randomly, if you can see, within less than 19 years, there had been 2-3 kings ruling and finishing off. Isn't it? This shows how weak the Mughals had gone. Now, next is Muhammad Shah, from 1720 till 1748. Now, this is a pretty long time. Yeah? Nearly, you can say 18 years. Now, let us see. Soon after coming to power, Muhammad Shah stripped the Sayyid brothers of their power and authority. He ruled for a long period and could have revived the empire. However, he did not even attempt to consolidate the empire. Powerful governors established independent kingdoms in different parts of the country. The Sikhs, Marathas, Jats, and Rajputs revolted against the Mughals. Now, all we need to know about him is that Muhammad Shah, he was the one out of so many earlier Mughal rulers, the later Mughal rulers, that he was at least good enough to have stayed for a longer time, isn't it? And if he would have tried, he could have easily revived the lost glory of the Mughal Empire back. He could have easily taken back the glory. He could have easily established himself as a, you know, good Mughal ruler. But he failed. He did not do so. Why? Because he was more into just sitting and relaxing. Okay. And he did not even consolidate his empire. Consolidate means hold back whatever you have. He let it go. If the Jats were taking, the Jats were powerful, the Marathas were powerful, the Rajputs were powerful, the Sikhs were powerful. So he did not take a fight against them. Though he was capable, though he had good stability over the kingdom, and he could have brought back the Mughal Empire, but he was not bothered. So he gave away. He gave away everything to these people, to Jats, to Sikhs, to Marathas, to Rajputs, and he was happy. He was not bothered for the welfare of the kingdom. He was only busy in acquiring the throne and ruling there. Here, all he wanted was to stay back peacefully. उसको लड़ाई झगड़ा नहीं करना था, उसको किंगडम की देखभाल नहीं करनी थी, उसको बस वो सीट हथियाए रखनी थी. That's it. That was his aim. Clear? Next we come on to invasion of Nadir Shah. Please write there important. Because with the invasion of Nadir Shah, down came crumpling the Mughal Empire. In 1739, that means the time when he was already ruling, Nadir Shah came. Invasion means to come and conquer the area, loot it, and then go back. He did not stay there, Nadir Shah. He came, did the invasion, and went back with all the loot and everything, all the luxuries. Okay? Let us see. During this period, the empire also faced two invasions. One in 1739 AD, Nadir Shah, the ruler of Iran, invaded India. He defeated the Mughals and carried away a large amount of treasure, including the Kohinoor diamond and the peacock throne of Shah Jahan. Please underline this. India once had the peacock throne, which was studded with jewels. Throne, jante ho kya hota hai? Kya hota hai? Raj gaddi. Wo peacock ke shape mein bani hui thi. Usko chura ke le gaya. Plus the Kohinoor diamond. Yes, it was taken away by Nadir Shah. Okay, and he was the ruler of Iran. His invasion was followed by that of Ahmad Shah Abdali, the second invasion. Please write, underline this paragraph. This is very informative and very important. So the next, after Nadir Shah in 1739, the next invasion was done in 1761 by Ahmad Shah Abdali. The Mughals could never recover from the after effects of these two invasions. And so finally, the Mughal Empire came to its dead.